As you know, I'm working on a city exploration game that takes place in a huge procedural city populated by over a million persistent NPCs. I have just finished refactoring my system of spawns and schedules that allows me to have so many NPCs in the first place, so today I'd like to take a deep dive into what I've changed and why, and share some more details on how it all works in the first place. And as always, a big shout out to my patrons on Patreon. I am very grateful to each and every one of you guys, and so far I've used the money I made from Patreon and YouTube to buy a microphone and most recently to travel to a conference where I pitched Venture City to publishers. I didn't get any follow-up from them so far, but it's still an opportunity I wouldn't have without your support. And if you'd like to become a patron, check out the link in the description. Let's start from the beginning. The original idea for the NPCs was to spawn them the way I spawn every other object in my procedural city, by proximity to the player. But this turned out to be tricky because I don't want the NPCs to just stand around in the same location all the time. They have to move throughout the city as people normally do. So I cannot simply assign a parent block or a parent building to each NPC and only spawn them when the player is close to that building, because they might be somewhere else at that time, or they might be on the way from one place to another. My solution to this problem was to calculate the positions of every single NPC dynamically, and then filter those positions by proximity to the player. The most efficient way I found to do this is by simulating the NPC schedules on the GPU and then writing them into a render target that I can read and filter at any time. And yes, I am aware that I can do it even more efficiently by using compute shaders, but I haven't really figured out how to get them to work in Unreal Engine, and it's not really a priority because a render target serves my purposes just fine. In order to simulate the full schedules of the NPCs and their positions in the world at any time, I need to know each character's home and work locations. This is a major challenge, seeing how the city is generated dynamically as the player moves through it, and the game simply may not have enough information about distant parts of the city to assign home and work locations to the characters from those parts. So my only option is to generate approximate locations and then turn them into more precise ones as the player approaches them. At first, I tried to generate home and work locations as random coordinates within the city. This immediately created two problems. One, the city is not supposed to be uniformly populated. Some areas should be denser than others. For example, sector centers with taller buildings. Not to mention that the city has areas like ponds and rivers, which should not be populated at all. And the second problem is that the work and home locations should not be too far from each other, as the NPCs only have a limited time to get from one place to another. I solved the first problem by introducing the city population density map. I did mention it in my first video on the NPCs, but I've made some changes to it since. At first, I only generated an approximate density map that only took sector density into account. As you can see, each sector has a peak and a falloff, which corresponds to how building heights are computed in the game world. There are also rivers and major roads, but no minor roads on this map. But the biggest problem with this level of precision is that it does not take individual blocks into account, which is a problem because some blocks may contain no buildings at all, for example ponds, and they may be pretty large in size. This causes some NPCs to spawn in the middle of a pond, as that area is still marked as populated on this low precision map, and that can be a problem. That's why I decided to improve the density map to take into account individual blocks rather than just the sectors. Initially, I calculated the density map as a simple data array stored in the memory. This visualization was just made for demonstration. I didn't actually render it to texture. But then I decided that I might need it for other purposes as well, and because it takes a bit of time to render, I might as well just store it as a texture that I can access later. I chose a 1024 by 1024 8-bit texture to store it, as the densities are approximate and I don't need a whole lot of precision for them. And a fun little side effect of having the population density stored as a texture is that I can create these maps of the city that can now be found in the public spaces. They look 3D, but there's no actual geometry there, so it's just a flat quad with a parallax shader applied to the density texture. And just to clarify, what I call population density is just an average height of buildings within a certain block that is normalized, from 0, where there are no buildings, to 1 at maximum building height. It still does not take into account individual buildings, so the streets between blocks, as well as public spaces within the blocks, are still counted as populated areas and may act as spawn points points for the NPCs. This is not a problem though, because the locations created from this density map are supposed to be approximate, and once the NPC is spawned and the more precise behavior system takes over, it routes them to the nearby buildings, as long as there is a building within a reasonable distance. Another side benefit of calculating the population density with more precision is that this process basically forces us to iterate through all of the city's sectors, districts, and blocks. So I decided that if I'm doing that anyway, I might as well use this opportunity to cache them for later use. Previously, I wasn't using any caching for calculating the city topology because I believed that this operation of subdividing a rectangle is cheap enough that I can just redo it whenever I need it and save the memory needed to store them. And they only need to be calculated when loading new areas, so I thought it wouldn't have much of an impact anyway. But once I started looking into it, it turned out that I could save a lot of computation by caching the city subdivisions like this, and there are actually a lot of game objects that request this information. So once I introduced caching, I immediately got a significant performance boost. Should have been obvious in hindsight. Now that I have a very decent density map, I'd like to go into a bit more detail on what I actually do with it. I already mentioned in my first NPC devlog that I'm using the inverse transform sampling technique, and I guess I should elaborate a bit on what it is and how I use it. The goal is to turn a random or pseudo-random number between 0 and 1, distributed uniformly, which is what you normally get when you use a standard random function, into a different random number that will be distributed according to the density map that we've already calculated. Let me give you a brief visual demonstration of how it actually works. This is a well-known method, so maybe you already know all this, but for those who don't, this visualization will help understand what's going on. Let's say we have this distribution that we want to roll a random number from, and a random number generator that can generate uniformly distributed values from 0 to 1. Also, even though our density map is two-dimensional, I will use a one-dimensional distribution here for simplicity. We need to create a cumulative distribution function from it by summing all of the discrete values and normalizing the result. What we get is this increasing curve with values from 0 to 1, which basically tells us for any given value which percentile of the distribution it belongs to. For example, if I pick a value of 0.4, the corresponding result is about 0.3, which means that roughly 30% of values of our original distribution are below 0.4. So when we inverse the CDF, we are in fact searching for a value that corresponds to a certain percentile. And because percentiles are always distributed uniformly, searching for a random percentile gives us exactly what we need, a non-uniformly distributed random number. And because in our case the values are discrete, we can easily inverse the CDF by doing a binary search through it to find the index of the element we are looking for. We can then convert this index back to a two-dimensional coordinate, and that is our final value that will conform to the density distribution. I hope this makes sense. Now that we got that out of the way, I've also made some changes to how work and home locations are calculated for the actual NPCs. First of all, I had a problem with generating both of them randomly, which is that sometimes they would be generated too far from each other and the NPCs would take too long to reach one location from another. I solved this by generating the home locations first, and then generating several different potential work locations for each NPC and picking one closest to their home. This ensures that most of them will live relatively close to their work, but still leaves enough randomness for occasional outliers. Another change I made is that previously the home and work locations would be calculated at the same time as the NPC schedules, but I decided to separate them and added an extra render target just for the home and work locations. It's pretty convenient to use a render target for this because I can store the home coordinates in the red and green channel and the work coordinates in the blue and alpha channels. They get calculated only once at the start of the game and then sampled by the GPU to compute the full schedules as the NPC goes through their day. Due to this change, I can now know for sure where each NPC lives or works, even without them being at the location. And it works the other way too. I can sample locations near the player to find out which NPCs live and work there, all at the cost of a little bit of VRAM. Oh, and while I'm at it, I have changed the distribution of work schedules to be clustered around the common 9-to-5 work hours. So now the majority of the NPCs will work around that time, creating rush hours in the morning and common leisure hours in the evening, which adds to the city feeling alive. There are still outliers who work at nights, of course, but they are rare. This is what that looks like on the render target when I speed up time. This is the channel that contains the phases of the NPCs, and the solid gray zone represents all the NPCs currently at work. It is solid because the work schedules are set to specific hours and are calculated from the character's x-coordinate on the render target. The other phases, as you can see, are noisy because they depend on each individual commute time and a randomness factor. So here's where I'm at currently. The performance has been improved significantly by these recent changes, but of course I'm still not quite done with it. There is still a lot more to be done, and I do remember that I promised a playtest for the NPCs, but I think I will only be able to prepare it by March or April, as I want to implement at least some basic interactions with the player before that happens. But for now, stay creative!